Our planet's temperatures and sea levels are rising fast. Global warming is a big problem, you might say. And big problems call for big solutions. Epic solutions. Hell, even biblical solutions. That's right, it might be time to build an ark, get on board, save life on Earth, have a nice warm pint, and wait for all this to blow over. But just how big would an ark need to be? Can we just copy the one Noah built in the Bible? And how many of each animal are we going to need so that we can rebuild?
I'm Stu, this is Debunked, and we're here to sort the truth from the myths and the facts from the misconceptions. Right, if we're getting biblical with this, the first port of call has to be, well, the Bible. And the good book is actually pretty specific about what God said to Noah.
Make yourself an ark of cypress wood, make rooms in it, and coat it with pitch, inside and out. This is how you are to build it. The ark is to be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high.
Now, a cubit is a slightly archaic unit of measure. Take the distance from the tip of a person's middle finger to their elbow, and you've got yourself a cubit. There's just a slight problem with the cubit. Different ancient cultures ended up with different distances. So a cubit can be anywhere between 45.5 centimeters or 17.9 inches to 52.3 centimeters or 20.6 inches. Still, that hasn't stopped people rebuilding Noah's Ark.
Johann Huber's Ark opened to the public in 2012 and measures 135 meters long, 30 meters wide, and 23 meters high. Another copy in Williamstown, Kentucky, USA, comes in at 155 meters long, 26 meters wide, or 15 meters high. So you see that cubits are very much open to interpretation. To put that into perspective, the Titanic was 269 meters or 883 feet long, 28 meters or 93 feet wide, and about 31 meters or 104 feet deep. Sure, it's even taller if you include everything, but you can't keep passengers in a funnel.
It's all well and good building a replica ark and popping it on dry ground, but in the flood to come, we want to make sure it will float. We don't want another Titanic-sized disaster.
The good news, folks, is that an ark built to the dimensions laid down in the Bible and made from cypress wood would float, according to a study at the University of Leicester. Using a cubit of 48.2 centimeters, 1.58 feet, this resulted in an ark measuring 144.6 meters long, 24.1 meters wide, and 14.46 meters tall, which is 474 feet long, 79 feet wide, and 47.4 feet high. Pretty close to those other replicas. Now, a boat that big, roughly the size of a small cargo ship, built out of cypress wood, is coming in at 1.2 million kilograms or 2.65 million pounds of weight, and would float pretty nicely in seawater. The study found it would only be dipping into water by 0.34 meters or 1.1 feet.
But we're not launching this vessel into the local boating lake. We need it to do a little more than just float. We need this to be truly seaworthy and withstand the largest flood the Earth has ever known. This is where biblical science starts to fall down.
A wooden vessel of this size in a biblical flood would come up against some critical structural issues when at sea. The ark may even break in half. You see, a smaller boat would comfortably float along the waves, over the crests and into the troughs. A vessel the size of Noah's Ark would instead suffer substantial strain as it crossed the waves, causing massive amounts of sagging and hogging, which would lead to structural failures in the middle portion of the ark at the top and bottom alternately as it travelled across the crest and trough of the waves. Structural failures like this even occur in large modern ships.
Noah's biggest design problem is that he is limited by the size of available trees.
Wood is a great material to build boats from. It's strong and light. However, without modern glues and steel plates, it's not possible for Noah to join all his beams together to create a single super beam strong enough to support the hull. Once he goes longer than an available trunk, he needs to build a giant wooden scaffold inside the boat to keep it from collapsing under the water pressure. Even then, wood isn't the stiffest material, so a well-reinforced biblical superyacht is going to bend like a banana in a big storm. The reasoning behind this is why the largest wooden ship ever constructed, the Wyoming in 1909, was only two-thirds the size of Noah's Ark. And even at this size, The Wyoming flexed and twisted, opening up seams in its hull, causing leaks that required pumps to keep the hold only relatively free of water. Despite these measures, it still eventually filled with water and sank in 1924. Subsequent wooden ships were reinforced with steel to ensure their seaworthiness. It's been suggested that Noah could have instead built a flotilla of smaller boats, which he could attach to one another with ropes and gangplanks. Then his fleet could move independently of each other and go with the flow of the waves rather than resisting them.
If Noah didn't have his naval engineering degree, he could always try just tying as many tree trunks together as possible and creating a giant raft. Cypress wood is about half the weight of water, so a fully submerged cubic meter of wood has enough buoyancy to support half a ton of animals.
But let's say the floods weren't at all like the scenes from the Aronofsky film. And let's instead say that the planned flood meant that the water levels would slowly rise, delicately lifting the ark from the ground and then gently floating around in calm waters for the next few months. More of a serene crew, shall we say. All we have to do now is load up all the species before the endgame. But what kind of cargo capacity would the ark have without overloading it and sending the future of all life plunging into the ocean depths? For this, we need to know the ark's buoyancy force, which, according to Archimedes' principle, is equal to the weight of the volume of water the ark displaces. The University of Leicester study could then estimate the total mass the ark could support before gravitational weight would overcome the buoyancy force and sink the ark. This was calculated as 50.54 times 10 to the power 6 kilograms. In other words, the ark could house 50 million kilograms, or around 55,000 US tons, of cargo without any trouble. I think we can all agree, that's a big load. The last thing to do then is start loading up all the animals before those sea levels start rising. The boffins at Leicester took the humble sheep as the average mass for the animals coming aboard, and at 23.47 kilograms or 51.74 pounds per sheep, the biblical ark would have been able to support 2.15 million sheep without sinking. That's of course if we're only talking about mass. That doesn't mean the ark can fit all those sheep inside. After all, the idea is to keep these animals alive, which means giving them a bit of space to live and breathe. According to official UK guidance, the space a sheep should have is around 1.2 square metres, or 12.9 square feet. Plus, they'll need a bit of room to stand up in. Again, to keep things simple, and to make it a cube, let's say 1.1 metres, or 3.6 feet. That means the space required to house a sheep on the ark is about 1.33 cubic meters, or 46.97 cubic feet. In transport, that space is lower, at 0.5 square meters, or 5.38 square feet per animal. We'll say 0.34 cubic meters, or 12 cubic feet. The hypothetical ark put forward by Leicester University had a capacity of just over 50,391 cubic meters. That's just under 1.8 million cubic feet, or in animal terms, 37,887 sheep living in comfort, or 148,209 sheep crammed in transport style.
All this begs the question, did Noah's Ark have enough space to do the job? Now, according to the Bible, God also laid down instructions about the number of animals he had to take with him.
Take with you 7 pairs of every kind of clean animal, a male and its mate, and 1 pair of every kind of unclean animal, a male and its mate, and also 7 pairs of every kind of bird, male and female, to keep their various kinds alive throughout the earth.
Just how many animals is that, though? In news that should not come as a shock, religion and science once again start to disagree here. Let's quickly address how biblical scholars interpret this.
The language used in the Bible here is crucial. Note how it mentions kinds of animals. This isn't particularly specific. It could mean anything ranging from species all the way up to their family level in scientific taxonomy. And there's a big difference between those classifications. At the species level, you take domestic dogs, grey wolves, coyotes, and a range of similar species. At the opposite end of the spectrum, if it was just from the same family, in this case Canidae, you just take a red fox and say, that'll do, no need for any dogs or wolves. We've got that animal family covered. Anyway, what that means according to biblical scholars is that Noah only had to take between 2,000 and 50,000 individual animals onto the ark to get the job done. In which case, there'd be more than enough space to ensure the survival of life. or that at least there's enough room to pack them all in until a storm hits, sinking the unseaworthy vessel, drowning the last of the remaining land dwellers.
But let's go back to our original scenario. Those pesky ice caps and rising sea levels are coming for us after all. What would it take to save all the species on Earth right now? Let's crunch the numbers.
Pinning down the exact number of animal species isn't easy. There could be up to 30 million species of invertebrates alone. However, a widely cited study in 2011 estimated there were approximately 8.7 million species on Earth. Thankfully, for the construction of our ark, we've only actually identified and classified 1.25 million of them so far.
It would be quite a challenge to get unidentified species on the boat, so they're going to get wet when the flood comes.
Right, so we're down to 1.25 million species, but to make things even more simple for our ark designers, not all of those species are animals. In fact, only 950,000 of living species were classified as such, the rest being plants, fungi, protozoa, those are single-celled organisms like amoebas, and chromista, which are things like algae. And the final trick we're pulling is that only 75% of species live on land. If you're used to water, then you're on your own. Or you'll need to seek refuge in one of those freshwater pockets or deep-sea aquifers. The end result is that we need to find space for 712,500 different species on the debunked ark. Then we come to the whole 2x2 mantra. Sure, it would technically ensure the survival of the species, but it's fair to say that the second generation of the ones after would be pretty inbred. Would the 7 pairs or 14 individuals also mentioned in the Bible be enough to keep things healthy? Probably not. The minimum viable population, or MVP, is the lowest number a biological group can fall to before the chances of extinction start to get serious. A small population might be wiped out by changes in the environment or a natural disaster, and over time, lack of genetic diversity can impact the health and adaptability of the group. In other words, the more the merrier.
So, what is the MVP for animals? Well, it depends.
Let's take humans. A 2002 study by anthropologist John Moore, in which he studied how many people would be needed for a 200-year space mission, concluded you'd need a population of 160. Over two centuries, you're looking at 8 to 10 generations. But because of the small starting population, you'd end up with a diminished genetic diversity over time. To stop this genetic drift, the space travelers would need to return to Earth after 200 years to mix things up. Comparatively, a 2019 study of 36 species of freshwater fish in the Yangtze River yielded MVPs ranging from 42 to 320. Other studies have concluded average MVPs across multiple species ranging from 4,169 to 7,316. However, since the 1980s, the so-called 5,500 rule was used as a general guide for MVP. The rule was put forward by Ian Franklin, an Australian geneticist, and Michael Sule, an American biologist. They claimed 50 was the magic number required to prevent inbreeding, and 500 was the number needed to keep genetic drift at bay. The 5,500 rule is questioned by many, and as we've seen, doesn't necessarily work as an easy catch-all. However, we'll go with 500, since we want to avoid genetic drift once all this flood business has died down. That means we need 500 individuals for each of the 712,500 land animals, leaving us with an ark that has to carry 356.3 million animals. Noah's ark suddenly seems really cramped, even in business class.
Now I know what you're thinking.
Stew, not all animals are the size of sheep.
And it's a good point. Just 3 to 5% of animals are vertebrates, meaning our ark has about 28,500 species that would be in sheep range. How much space would they need?
At 0.34 cubic meters or 12 cubic feet per animal and 500 animals per species, we're looking at 4,845,000 cubic meters or 171,099,560 cubic feet, if we're crabbing them in transport style. Well, we still have 96% of animals needing a home, but the good news is that invertebrates aren't massive. So if we say all invertebrates aboard have the average size of the common pavement ant, around 3 mil or 0.1 inch in length, how much space are these little ones going to need? Alternatively, if we're being more generous, we could base our invertebrate section on the megaloblatter longi penis, which holds the world record for the largest cockroach at 97 millimeters in length and 45 millimeters across. That would leave us needing this. For quick maths and to make sure there's enough space for all the terrifying bird-eating tarantulas, we'll say our debunked ark needs 5 million cubic meters. That's a little over 176.5 million cubic feet, which is a long way of saying that Noah's ark is too small to save life on Earth. We'd actually need a fleet of 100 arcs, or a larger flotilla, or even smaller wooden arcs, as our structural engineer previously suggested.
Have humans ever come close to building a gargantuan 5 million cubic meter vessel? No, but we've probably come closer than you think.
Take the Seawise Giant, which was constructed way back in 1979. The vessel was 458 meters or 1,504 feet long, 30 meters or 98 feet deep, and 69 meters or 225 feet wide, giving it a rough capacity of 937,000 cubic meters or over 33 million cubic feet. It wasn't a practical ship, however. When fully loaded, it would sit 24 meters, nearly 75 feet below the ocean's surface, and it was so big, it couldn't navigate the English Channel, the Panama Canal, or the Suez Canal. And it was longer than the Empire State Building is tall.
The bad news, it was scrapped for metal in 2010, so we'll need to build a new ark in time for the next great flood. Well, actually, we'll need five of them.
But wait! What about feeding the beasts? Well, Noah's Ark was afloat for 150 days, and keeping with our control source, a sheep would consume 150 kilograms of grass over that period, whereas your average common ant would only consume up to 0.0015 kilograms. That would leave us with 3,420 kilograms of food for all our invertebrates, and a whopping 51.3 billion kilograms for all our vertebrates. That's 56 million US tons. The world's largest container vessel can theoretically carry around 232 million kilograms of cargo. That's over 256,000 US tons, meaning we'd need 195 of these to keep our passengers alive over the 150-day voyage. Blimey.